Hey everyone, John Hardy here with Saxo Bank FX Update. And our title today is The Time to Abandon the QE3 Ship. Apparently, Bernanke disapproving of the market's immediate recognition or reaction to his rhetoric yesterday, actually taking the trouble to sort of beat back the idea that the Fed stands ready to do something at this time. And this has seen some, at least some reversal in some places of the move, the dollar firming up quite a bit today, and certainly risk coming off quite sharply when that rhetoric came out this morning as he's testifying and having a Q&A session in front of the Senate today versus the House yesterday. What else do we have in today's highlights? The Italian bond auctions were quote-unquote successful. However, rates not really doing much. There was some confidence vote on Berlusconi's budget, which was passed. Not much market reaction there. And apparently this whole Italian budget is a bit of a tricky creature, as a lot of it is back-weighted to 2013 and 2014 to supposedly help the sitting government through the elections election cycle, which, if my memory serves correct, is next year. So basically in a holding pattern on the sovereign debt spreads and those bank stress tests up tomorrow for Europe. Now, what else do we have today? Quite a bit of data out, none of it sort of vastly different from expectations, and a bit mixed. Retail sales was a bit on the weak side on the ex-autos and gas number, but not a massive miss there. Jobless claims coming in a decent amount better than expected, but we have, I think it was at 405K, but then we have last week's, every time we get a release, the previous weeks are revised upward, so we never know how much that upward revision is going to be. It's always in the wrong direction, and that's a bit discouraging, as last week's was ratcheted another 9K up from its original reading to 425 or 6, and still above the 400 level on jobless claims. And also, this is a very sort of weak season or slow season in terms of job firings, it being the summer. So there's a heavy seasonal adjustment component to this particular time of year. The PPI was mixed. We had the headline coming in below expectations, but the core reading bumping up to the highest level since I think it was the spring of 2009 that when I looked at the data there. And again, Bernanke toning down QE expectations. This saw quite a move intraday in risk. Pro-risk trades saw equities coming off quite heavily again. Still, some of what you could argue is the QE3 trade, out there, as we still see gold pretty high, even if it's $5-6 off of the highs, which were new record highs on the day. And we have the debt ceiling circus, and especially a circus because the market completely dumps on Bernanke's comments, and then we get a rally that almost backs half of that out, as there was some announcement from the White House that they've come together on $1.5 trillion in cuts. Not a whole lot of details over what time frame, et cetera, but this is it's getting kind of ridiculous how we're bouncing around from headline to headline. And I think some of the action here later in the day, I'm coming at you a little over an hour before New York closes, suggesting that indeed the market is tiring of this. So market reaction, I think I've pretty much covered that. One thing I didn't discuss, there was a U.S. T-bond auction today. The auctions have been pretty strong from where I sit anyway, considering we're a post-QE2 environment. The indirect bidder participation not particularly strong on this auction, but the bid to cover was reasonably okay. And all things considered, all right, a B auction in my not very estimable estimation. Themes out there, okay, of course, the euro situation is still very fluid. We've come off of the sort of the spike fears as the ECB and perhaps China as well bidding enough in the market to keep those sovereign spreads stabilized. But it's clear that Europe is sort of about to hit a brick wall here in terms of its approach to the sovereign debt problems. It can't continue as it has before, as we're spreading now to Italy. So it's going to have to come up with a new way of dealing with this. It's not to say that the euro is going to be torn completely apart, but it's the landscape is changing, the situation is changing, and either Europe is going to have to pull together and take a different approach, take the write-downs, take the defaults, the restructurings, or it is going to risk some kind of a disorderly rendering into its individual parts. That's not a prediction, the latter part. It's just suggesting we're getting to the point where a different course of action is going to need to be taken. The U.S. debt ceiling, and again, this is something that John Taylor brought up sometime back, actually, and a bit of prescience there, and Bob Janjua as well, chiming in that he believes, and I tend to agree with this, that the more sort of intractable the debt ceiling debate becomes, and the more difficult its passage, it's actually somewhat dollar positive in terms of the implications for U.S. sovereign debt sustainability, etc., because it suggests that the political arena is getting more serious about dealing with the issue. So that's one to keep in mind. Not sure how much worry is really priced into the market here. Some of the action today is suggesting there is some worry priced in because of the way it reacts, but on the other hand, it seems like the market just looking for any excuse to jump around any random headline. The shape of QE3, this is an important one. I wrote a piece that's out on TradingFloor.com that I hope you saw. Put it out late yesterday when a lot of folks around the world are asleep, unfortunately, but still stand by that article. Have a look. See if I can figure out what it's called here. And basically, excuse that, if we look at, what was the title of the article here? Bernanke's testimony, is it a QE3 hint or a dose of cynicism? The dose of cynicism being that Bernanke hoping to just lay out a suggestion into the environment here that if things really go bad, don't worry, the Fed's going to do something. I think that was his intention, more than trying to hint that something specific was on the way now. And if something is on the way in the shape of QE3, in terms of QE3, it is not going to be a repeat, simple replay of QE2. I think even the Fed in its infinite not-so-smartness, to put it politely, has probably learned a lot of valuable lessons from QE2, among those that pumping liquidity into the system doesn't do much for the real economy and only pumps up financial assets, which they would like in some cases, but I think they also see the downsides in other cases. So whatever form QE3 takes, it will not be the same. It'll be a twist, perhaps an operation twist, as it's been called, in which they target longer rates. And indeed, Bernanke did mention that in his testimony, as a possibility for how the Fed might respond if new stimulus is needed. And in such an instance, it might even consider raising short-term rates. That's a revolutionary idea there. No sign of the market pricing this in, just a thought to put out there. Raising the short-term rates to keep the dollar from collapsing, to keep the commodity speculation at bay and the sort of the free ride speculation, if you will, out there, while aiming at what is hitting the average person's pocketbook the worst, and that's longer-term lending rates and things like housing to keep the housing prices high, etc. Could be an idea of how QE3 shapes out. Regardless, the important thing today being that Bernanke sort of wanting to underline that he's not looking to do something at this time and that nothing is sort of in the works here. Of course, if we see some absolutely horrific data, we might see something more specific shape up at Jackson Hole. It's just not something we're going to look for at the next meeting anyway. Other important items out there, dollar yen below 80. This is key for the market. One of the big banks circulating some data on the positioning in the local Tokyo futures market, suggesting the retail is very, very short the yen after its success in doing that back in March. It tends to be the retail traders have a hard time catching things the right way. So that will be interesting. That's an interesting data point to consider there. Of course, the direction and rates being key for yen crosses. Looking ahead, of course, we're in this environment of headline risk, very unreliable markets, everything zooming back and forth both ways, really sort of eroding people's confidence in their trades and their ability to see what's going to happen next. And unfortunately, it kind of breeds similar reactions to the next data headline, the next event, etc. So until we sort of settle into some real trends, it seems like we may have the risk of this kind of thing continuing. Specific calendar risks here. We have the EU bank stress test of tomorrow, supposedly. Let's see how transparent those are, how many pass or fail, etc. And the details, apparently they're hoping for a lot of transparency on this publishing of these results. U.S. CPI, U.S. Empire Manufacturing, very interested in that one, the first regional manufacturing survey for July. and the first reading for U.S. Michigan consumer confidence. And of course, more corporate earnings coming in. I haven't been updating myself a lot on those, as we had so many other things going on here. And of course, the U.S. debt ceiling maneuvering. Was it today? I think Obama said he wanted to invite some lawmakers to Camp David, and Boehner said forget about it. So it's getting pretty acrimonious out there on that debate. Please follow me on Twitter at John J. Hardy. I send out a few links, comments, once in a while, timely updates if I'm in front of the screen right when I see something pop up. And if you have any questions, you can also mention me, etc. Let's have a look at the charts. Here is Eurodollar, and we're seeing that this old consolidation line of consolidation is yet to be taken out. We've had quite a bounce here after the massive sell-off, so some hope for the bears there, but obviously the violent two-way action is a cause for concern for the bears as well. Let's see it come back down below 140 to get more confidence in the view that this this break below the line of consolidation is going to hold. Cable, tremendous bounce here, helps keep some credibility that this range, general range around the 160 area, may hold for a while. Also interesting to note, though, that the old sort of head and shoulders line that I've actually just had here for quite some time, I think I drew it back here before this break, this was tested here and has failed to fall on this latest run-up as well. I think a lot of the cable upside is driven by euro sterling selling, which we're seeing here. 55-day, an obvious focus there, and the next focus is going to be the 86, whatever this is low, and the 200-day moving average currently at 86, 63 area. Euro Swiss getting the stick again after it tried to rally a bit, as there is no real improvement in the euro situation and lots of uncertainty. Dollar Swiss trying to bounce a little bit as the dollars come back on the Bernanke comments aimed at resisting the market's attempt to react too strongly to the QE3 trade. Euro yen behaving like a lot of the risk trades, and dollar yen having quite a wide range today and looking like it's headed for a close, a long-legged doji kind of close, which suggests a lot of uncertainty there. Could be a lot of stops on a trade like this. I think there's been a lot of assumption that 80 would not fall. But again, watch interest rates on that one. Aussie Canada, still a mess on that. We have crude oil prices coming off quite heavily in the U.S., but the Brent hasn't been affected as much. Kiwi exploding higher. It feels like we should have stayed lower after this nice technical rejection of the high, but apparently that was those that were stopped out of the market felt like they had to get back in, and we saw it rush to new highs on a strong GDP figure. But let's keep in mind this was a Q1 GDP figure out of New Zealand, and we're seeing this kind of steepness is often have a hard time sustaining that for long. Still, there's no reversal yet. It is what it is. It's a strong move higher. It just doesn't look too pretty structurally. We have some divergent momentum here if it comes back lower. Similar to here, we had new highs on not particularly good momentum and towards the end of this run-up as well. So let's see what happens in the next couple of days. It will be decided if we'll stay above this 83 area, old high for the cycle. Of course, trades like gold versus euro and versus the dollar, really, although we're off about $8 now in gold in dollar terms, but quite a run-up there. An expression, really, the gold market of the sovereign debt strains. Silver strong, but not as strong. Excuse me for that. And Aussie, remarkably, unlike Kiwi, Aussie still, this 107.80 seems to be a very strong resistance area there. Still, if you're, this range has just been awfully persistent, and tactically, you'd like to see the 55-day give way again to help out with the downside view towards the bottom of the range, towards 104. And I wanted to show you one thing here, if it's up in the proper place. Proper place, but not the proper size. This is the year forward expectations, thanks to Bloomberg's display, and this is a Credit Suisse measure of year forward expectations for the RBA. So we've been at 40 in, as recently as May, on the positive side. Now we're getting close to minus 40 bips year forward on the RBA. a lot of areas of the Australian economy looking like they're headed towards recession. And it's really only some commodities and a little bit of risk appetite that has kept the Aussie up. That risk appetite is crumbling today again, so we don't have a lot of good technical arguments with this kind of chart, but we certainly have fundamental arguments isolated for a weak Aussie. Dollar Canada is somewhat of a mess. Looks like the 7.64, this final retracement area, is still somewhat sort of in a last gasp attempt at providing some support. You'd like to see the 55-day giveaway again to the upside for a better technical sign of resilience from the dollar on that currency pair. Again, Brent not doing much. The S&P failing a bit again here with the Bernanke comments, and that 200-day moving average will be the big focus if we get back lower again there. Euro stocky pulling off that 920, what shall we call it, 926 area, again 927. But again, stocky very much positively correlated with risk, so that's one of the reasons we're seeing it come off again on that one. All right, so that'll about do it for today. Awful lot of interesting inputs this week. Tomorrow we have more with the European bank stress test, and now the post-Bernanke comments aimed at discouraging the notion that we should be expecting QE3 imminently, also important in this market. Feels like there's plenty of room to remain nervous in this market and beware of the pro-risk trades out there that have tried to get us back on board as recently as yesterday. But let's see what happens, and in the meantime, we'll be back as soon as possible with further additions. We'll be back tomorrow with a FX Weekly Wrap, hopefully, so that you can view over the weekend. Take care out there.